the WrestleMania 20 years in the making, where everyone is all grown up, as World Wrestling Entertainment presents WrestleMania 23, taking place on April 1st, 2007, from Ford Field in Detroit, Michigan. The attendance for this show was a sellout 80,103, 74,687 of which paid. The live gate for this show was $5,380,000, and the pay-per-view buys for this show was $1,200,000. All three of these metric numbers were higher than WrestleMania 22, and WrestleMania 23 set then records for both live gate and pay-per-view buys. Live gate would be broken the following year, but pay-per-view buys would stand until 2012. WrestleMania 23 is the second most bought WrestleMania in history and the fifth most attended WrestleMania in history, and this WrestleMania was my one and only WrestleMania that I attended live in person. Compared to the rest of the WWE pay-per-views in 2007, WrestleMania 23 was the highest in all three metric numbers, attendance, live gate, and pay-per-view buys. Your commentators for the night: for Raw, you had Jim Ross and Jerry Lawler. For SmackDown, you had Michael Cole and John Bradshaw Layfield, and for ECW, you had Joey Styles and Taz. Your dark match for the night was a Lumberjack tag team match where Ric Flair and Carlito defeated Cruiserweight champion Chavo Guerrero and Gregory Helms. The fact that Ric Flair was on a dark match for the biggest show of the year is a complete shame. After the dark match and an awesome throwback of having Aretha Franklin sing America the Beautiful as she did 20 years earlier at WrestleMania 3, it was on to the main show itself, consisting of 8 total matches, 4 of which were for championships, 1 of which was for a briefcase, and 1 of which would see a bald billionaire. But before I get to the matches, the 2007 WWE Hall of Fame class and main non-wrestling segment. The 2007 Hall of Fame is low-key one of the better Hall of Fame classes in history. You had Dusty Rhodes, Kurt Hennig, Jim Ross, Jerry Lawler, Nick Bockwinkel, Mr. Fuji, The Sheik, and the Wild Samoans. As for the main non-wrestling segment of the night, Crime Time were trying to cheer up newly bald Eugene with ECW's Extreme Exposé, but Eugene would rather dance with Fabulous Moolah and Mae Young. Then you had the gamut of legends and former past names coming in and all dancing, culminating with Ron Simmons coming in and saying his trademark catchphrase, "Damn." But now on to the matches of WrestleMania 23, and we kick things off with a stacked one. Match number 1, the Money in the Bank ladder match. Winner gets a world title shot anytime against any world champion they choose over the next year. You had Mr. Kennedy, Jeff Hardy, Matt Hardy, Finlay, CM Punk, Edge, King Booker, and Randy Orton. They increased the competitors from 6 to 8 this year and had representatives from each of the brands. Each guy won qualifying matches in order to make this match, and in terms of names, this was one of the more stacked Money in the Bank matches they've ever done, and it was a phenomenal way to open WrestleMania. This was one of the better openers in WrestleMania history. Everybody got stuff in during the match. Punk did the Terry Funk spot with the ladder. The moment of the match was Jeff's leg drop onto Edge through another ladder, Edge getting stretchered away. Orton with the RKO on Punk off a ladder. Booker with the bookend on Orton off a ladder. Kennedy hit Hornswoggle with the Green Bay plunge off a ladder, and so much more. Speaking of Kennedy, he was the guy heading into this show I was going for in this match. He was one of those new crop of talent that I was like, that guy's gonna be a future world champion. Unfortunately, that never happened in WWE, but I was one for one on the night as Kennedy hit Punk with a ladder, climbed up, retrieved the briefcase, and Mr. Kennedy defeated Jeff Hardy, Matt Hardy, Finlay, CM Punk, Edge, King Booker, and Randy Orton in 24 minutes, 10 seconds to become Mr. Money in the Bank. Up next was match number 2, and it was an interpromotional battle of the monsters. The Great Khali of Raw versus Kane of SmackDown. Not really a good match between these two, but at least they kept it short. This was done for a couple of reasons. One, to start ramping up Khali for his eventual WWE title program not long after WrestleMania, and two, to recreate the Hogan-Andre slam from WrestleMania III when Kane slammed Khali. Khali would get the one boot pin after his double arm choke bomb as the great Khali defeated Kane in 5 minutes 30 seconds. After that was match number 3, and it was the first of 4 championship matches on the night. This one was for the WWE United States Championship. Champion Chris Benoit versus challenger Montel Vontavious Porter. Chris Benoit was in his third reign under the WWE banner as United States Champion, defeating Mr. Kennedy during the October 10th, 2006 SmackDown taping. In the build to WrestleMania, MVP was proving to everyone he was the real United States Champion, defeating the champions of other countries from all around the world, most notably the champion of Liechtenstein, Cedric Von Hausen, the future Johnny Gargano. MVP got the big entrance with the cheerleaders, and MVP was another name of that new crop of talent. I was like, this guy's gonna be a future world champion. While that never happened, he did end up managing the WWE champion. But this US title match between Benoit and MVP was a really good match. One of the better US title matches at WrestleMania. While that's not saying much, doesn't take away from this one. Overall, this was a gem in WrestleMania history. One of the better matches on the night. Benoit made MVP look amazing, and while even then I thought MVP should have won the US title on this night, I was not disappointed at all. Benoit hit the diving headbutt and it was all over as Chris Benoit defeated Montel Vontavious Porter in 9 minutes 15 seconds to retain the United States Championship. Following that was match number 4, and it was the second of 4 championship matches on the night. This one was for the World Heavyweight Championship. Champion Batista versus challenger and 2007 Royal Rumble winner, The Undertaker. Batista was in his second reign as World Heavyweight Champion, defeating King Booker at Survivor Series 2006. After Undertaker's Rumble win, he confronted all three world champions, WWE Champion John Cena, ECW Champion Bobby Lashley, and World Heavyweight Champion Batista. He ultimately chose Batista to face at WrestleMania. This was the biggest match the SmackDown brand could do at this WrestleMania, and these two were the two top guys on the show. These two would team up to face Raw's main event, John Cena and Shawn Michaels, on two different occasions, each side trading wins. During those tag matches is where tension started to build between the two, as this was a face versus face match, but Undertaker was the clear crowd favorite here. Not that the fans hated Batista, they just loved Undertaker more. This was a fantastic world title match. Shocking this went on in the middle of the card. You would think this would have gone last given the fact Undertaker won the Royal Rumble match and the moment of the results. You want to send the fans home happy and this is the way to do it. Big physical hoss fight between these two. Batista showed zero fear. Taker hit all his big moves. Taker kicked out of the Batista bomb, but Batista would not kick out of the tombstone, as Undertaker was now 15-0 at WrestleMania. Big celebration post-match, as 10 years after his last world title win at a WrestleMania, he does it again, as The Undertaker defeated Batista in 15 minutes 46 seconds to win the World Heavyweight Championship. Match number 5 was after that one, and it was an 8-man tag team match. The ECW Originals, Rob Van Dam, Sabu, Sandman, and Tommy Dreamer versus The New Breed, Elijah Burke, Kevin Thorne, Marcus Corvan, and Matt Stryker. There was a turf war in ECW between the Originals and the New Breed to see who is the most dominant force of the revived ECW brand. This was an alright match here, but it was going to be really hard to be the match to take place after Undertaker won the World Heavyweight title. Everybody got something in, but the result here was never in doubt as RVD hit Stryker with the 5-star frog splash to win the match, the ECW Originals defeated the New Breed in 7 minutes 27 seconds. Up next was match number 6, and this was the selling point of WrestleMania 23, the Battle of the Billionaires. ECW World Champion Bobby Lashley representing Donald Trump versus Intercontinental Champion Umaga representing Vince McMahon. Neither belt was on the line in this match, but neither belt mattered in the grand scheme of things, as the loser of the match lost the hair of the billionaire that they were representing. To make sure everything was even, Stone Cold Steve Austin would be the special referee. This entire program began with a match being made between a fake Trump and a fake Rosie on an episode of Raw. During Fan Appreciation Night, Trump interrupted and dropped money on the crowd. Then a challenge was made for the Battle of the Billionaires. Vince McMahon and Donald Trump would pick someone to represent them. They have a match. The losing billionaire would lose their hair. Vince picked Intercontinental Champion Umaga. Trump picked ECW champion Bobby Lashley. Now, the Bobby Lashley-Umaga pairing was actually Plan D when it comes to this match, as the original idea, Plan A for the Battle of the Billionaires, was going to be Hulk Hogan versus The Big Show. They wanted to recreate WrestleMania III with Hogan and Andre, so have Hogan versus the guy who was once Andre's son. However, when Show left the company in December, Plan B became Hogan versus Khali. They could still recreate WrestleMania III Hogan versus the Big Giant. However, Hogan and Vince had a falling out, probably over money, so in came Plan C, Shawn Michaels versus King Booker, giving us a match we hadn't seen on a main stage like WrestleMania before. However, plans had to change yet again when Triple H tore his quad at New Year's Revolution. Shawn took Hunter's spot on this show, more on that later. Booker was moved to Money in the Bank, and now Plan D, Bobby Lashley versus Umaga. Although when you really think about it, the representatives didn't really matter because the draw of this match was Vince and Trump. Love them or hate them, this was the match that got 1.2 million buys on pay-per-view. People were intrigued in this one. And this one delivered. People talk the build and the hype in the post-match, but rarely do people actually talk about the match itself, and Bobby vs. Umaga is an underrated gem on this show and in this show's history. Austin did his thing. Shane interfered, hit the coast-to-coast, Trump with a clothesline on Vince and he started to punch him, Austin with a stunner, Bobby with a spear, and it was all over, as Bobby Lashley defeated Umaga in 13 minutes. Post-match, Vince tried to escape and avoid the head shaving, but he was caught and thrown back into the ring. Austin, Lashley, and Trump all started to shave Vince bald. This was one of the few times they actually did the head shaving complete, as by the end of it all, Vince was bald. And going back and watching the show with commentary, I love the continuity line about after all these years, we find out the greatest mystery of them all, it was actually Vince's real hair this entire time, because it was the running gag for years when Vince was on commentary, that was not his real hair, it was actually a toupee. But Austin ended up stunning Trump and he celebrated with beer. After that was the penultimate match of WrestleMania 23, match number 7. The third of four championship matches on the night. This one was a lumberjill match for the WWE Women's Championship, champion Melina versus challenger Ashley. Melina was in her first reign as women's champion, defeating Mickie James on the February 19th, 2007 episode of Raw. Ashley was the WWE Playboy cover girl of 2007 and got a women's title match at WrestleMania to help advertise the magazine. This match almost got scrapped from the card due to the post-match of the Battle of the Billionaires, but at the last second they were allowed to compete, but not given much time. Melina with a bridge pin for the 3, as Melina defeated Ashley in 3 minutes 40 seconds to retain the Women's Championship. And with 7 matches down and one more match to go, it's on to match number 8 and the main event of WrestleMania 23. This was the 4th and final championship match of the night, and this one was for the WWE Championship. champion and one half of the World Tag Team Champions John Cena versus challenger and the other half of the World Tag Team Champions Shawn Michaels. John Cena was in his third reign as WWE Champion, defeating Edge at Unforgiven 2006. Like I pointed out before, the initial plans for this WrestleMania was a WrestleMania 22 rematch between John Cena and Triple H for the WWE Championship. But when Hunter tore his quad weeks before the Rumble, plans for this one changed. Shawn was fast-tracked to becoming number one contender for the WWE Championship. The two even won the World Tag Titles from Rated RKO the night after the Royal Rumble. Even though it was pointed out how John shouldn't trust Shawn, Shawn agreed to have Cena's back until WrestleMania. That was until Shawn superkicked Cena on the Go Home episode of Raw. Shawn came out to the D-Generation X theme, while Cena had the car entrance through the Mania glass. However, neither guy had their World Tag Title belt. On the live version, pre-match, you had an attempted streaker who was promptly removed from the building. Shawn even waved goodbye to the person who jumped the barricade. Then the match happens between Cena and Shawn. This was one of the best main events in WrestleMania history, but for whatever reason, this match barely gets recognized as such. Maybe because of their London Marathon match they had weeks after this one on Raw, this one gets kinda shoved under the rug. However, make no mistake about it, this one was great. A very pro Shawn Michaels and very anti John Cena crowd here. Great back and forth contest. Cena hit everything and Shawn still fought back. The moment of the match where I thought it was over is where Shawn hit sweet chin music. It was not, as Cena locked in another STFU on Shawn and Michaels tapped out. Post-match, Shawn refuses to shake Cena's hand, but in the end here, John Cena defeated Shawn Michaels in 28 minutes 20 seconds to retain the WWE Championship, the only wrestler in history to win or retain a world championship in three consecutive WrestleManias. I'm biased when it comes to this one because I loved WrestleMania 23. Being there live was an awesome experience. Looking back and watching the show again, it still holds up as a great WrestleMania. It was not a perfect WrestleMania, but the big matches on the night delivered in a big way. Both world title matches were awesome, the US title match was really good, Money in the Bank was fantastic, and Battle of the Billionaires was really damn fun. I absolutely recommend WrestleMania 23 to those who have never seen it before, and if you haven't seen it in a while, check it out again. Now on to the Golden Ring Bell and Brown Ring Bell for WWE WrestleMania 23. I give the Golden Ring Bell for Best Match to John Cena versus Shawn Michaels, and I give the Brown Ring Bell for Worst Match to Melina versus Ashley. But those are just my thoughts. Share your thoughts on WrestleMania 23 in the comments section below. Ask questions about this show, what was your favorite and least favorite match on the night, and what WrestleMania or WrestleManias have you attended live in person? Until next time, peace.
It's the interview queen, Alicia Tu, and I would like to introduce you all to From the Vault, a weekly wrestling discussion hosted by James over on We Are Pro Wrestling on YouTube. Since 2017, From the Vault has covered various wrestling topics from the past, like pay-per-views, wrestler retrospectives, and much, much more. Make sure to subscribe and click the notification bell. Whatever episode you're actually listening to, whether current or archived, don't forget to like, comment, and share. And last but not least, like him on Facebook, follow him on Twitter, be sure to support, because you will get tons of updates on future episodes there. All links are down below, so what are you waiting for? Go enjoy. Bye!